Welcome, everybody, to our summer forum today. And a few quick announcements before we move on to the main subject of the summer forum. The first is that, as we've announced a few weeks back, Harold Strawn passed away. He was, among many other things, he was in charge of summer forum for many years. And his memorial service will be this Saturday, so Saturday of this next weekend, August 28th at 11 a.m. via Zoom. So please, if you knew Harold and would like to attend his memorial service, everyone is invited to do so. And please join us next Saturday at 11 a.m. Via Zoom. Also, another sad announcement is that Bill Olson, a very, very long time member of our congregation and a very active member of our congregation, both him and his family, his wife, his children, his grandchildren have all been really, really key members of our congregation. Bill has passed away. He passed away on August 9th, and they're still figuring out details regarding memorial service, but when those details are available, we will be sharing them as well. All right. On to a much more joyful topic. The Saturday's Voyeur, the very long time send up of all things Salt Lake and Utah, that has been playing in Utah for 43 years and that began at our church in Elliott Hall in 1978. Is doing a final road show to say thank you and farewell to everyone in Salt Lake that can attend, who's been attending for all of these decades. And we are bringing it back to First Unitarian Church as well. So last week, Nancy Borgenek, the writer of Saturday's Voyeur, was our guest for Summer Forum. And we announced that we would be doing a performance on August 28th. The August 28th performance, first off, we've moved the time from 8 p.m. to 7 p.m. To adjust basically for the amount of light that we will have, as the performance will be outside on Goldsmith Plaza. That performance is sold out. However, we have opened up a second performance on Sunday, September 19th at 7 o'clock p.m., also on Goldsmith Plaza. So if you would like to get tickets for that and would like to join us, we would love to have you there. And there will be a link that you can use to get tickets to that we'll be sharing in summer form on the chat in the break period between the presentation and the Q&A session. On to the main event for today, and that is our guest, Representative Sandra Hollins, who is joining us today. And I will let Don, who is going to be our master of ceremonies for that, take it from here.
Okay, good morning. I'm Don Walton, and our guest speaker today is Sandra Hollins. Sandra represents District 23 in the Utah House of Representatives. District 23 is in the northwest section of Salt Lake City. Sandra has a master's in social work from the University of Utah. As a result, her professional and her political emphasis is on mental health, homeless shelters, and substance abuse treatment programs. Sandra was elected to the House in 2014 with 62% of the vote. She was reelected in 2016 and in 2018. And in 2020, she garnered 73% of the vote. She lives in Fair Park with her husband, David. They have two daughters. The rest of her interesting story, I'm going to leave for her to tell. Sandra Hollins, welcome to Summer Forum.
Thank you, Don. Thank you. And thank you to the First Unitarian Church for this invite. I am absolutely honored to be here. You know, I serve with one of your members, Representative Liz Wade, and I have to tell you, she's a jewel up at the Capitol and works just as hard as I do to make sure that people's voices are heard up at the Capitol. So thank you for the invite today. I want to apologize up front that I cannot stay for the fellowship afterwards. I am in travel mode right now. After I complete this, I'm going to be running to the airport to get on a flight to come back to Salt Lake City. I am in Louisiana right now. My husband is from Mississippi. I'm from Louisiana. And unfortunately, my husband's mother has health problems. And so we fly back and forth to take care of her, but also to check in on my mom. And making sure that she's okay during this time of COVID. Fortunately, my mom is very healthy, but we fly back and forth. I fly back and forth to check on them and on both of them. So, but it's my honor to be here. As said, I'm Representative Sandra Hollins. I represent District 23. And so today I'm just gonna spend a little time talking to you about my role as a state legislator. And why I am passionate about the issues that I am passionate about. We all know that we have things in our lives and our upbringing shapes who we are. And I want to talk a little bit about those events that have happened in my life and those people who have been a part of my life who have shaped me, shaped my thinking and shaped my values. And because of them, I am who I am, and I always acknowledge them and acknowledge that I stand on a lot of people's shoulders. I could not be who I am and where I am without the hard work of people who have gone before me. So as I said earlier, I grew up in New Orleans, and there were three things that I always said shaped my life growing up in New Orleans, and that was family, community, and faith. I want to talk first a little bit about my family. I grew up, I was the second of five kids in a household. It was four girls and one boy. Grew up in a very, very strong family. Grew up with my father, who was from Mississippi, who worked, who gave me my work ethics and my work values. He, for as far as I could remember from a little girl, always worked two or three jobs. My father worked at a grocery store, and he always cleaned buildings in the evening. And a lot of times I went with him. In fact, that was one of my first jobs, was cleaning buildings to help pay for some of the things I needed in high school. Always very, very hard worker. I remember him going to work sometime 3 or 4 in the morning and not getting off work to 10, 11 o'clock at night. And he always did what he had to do to take care of our family. He was the primary breadwinner. And unfortunately, because of his health issues and health problems and him working so hard, he had a stroke and passed at an early age. He was only 61 years old when he passed in 1998. But he was the disciplinarian in the family, raised us strong women in the family. Like I said, it was four girls and one boy. And he taught us early on as young girls that you need to learn how to take care of yourself. I don't want you all dependent on anybody to be able to take care of you. So I think I was the only 5 or 6 year old that knew how to write a check, because he wanted to make sure we knew how to write a check. We knew how to do all of these things to be able to support ourselves. My mother was the spiritual person in the family. She always worked from home babysitting kids in the neighborhoods. In particular, women who worked outside of the home, she would keep their kids and really wouldn't charge them a lot. I remember my mom would only charge $20 a week to babysit kids in the neighborhood, because she knew the value of the parents. And these moms had to work. And so a lot of that giving back to the community, I learned from her. But as I said, she was very, very spiritual in the family. Made sure that we were in church, made sure that we knew that we had faith. And so this is what she instilled in me and all of her kids. the community I grew up in was the Lower Ninth Ward. Now, many of you may recognize that name because it was one of the communities that was destroyed during Hurricane Katrina in 2005, I believe it was. The neighborhood I grew up in, where one of the levees breached, the house that I grew up in was destroyed, was one of the homes that was destroyed by Hurricane Katrina. And so that was the community I grew up in, but I grew up in a community with all of these wonderful people in my school system and just in the community in general. The community is an all Black community. I went to church in this community. I went to school in this community. We shopped in this community. And so these were the people that developed me and I got to know growing up. And some of them, I am still friends with a lot of these individuals. The school I went to, like I said, was an all Black school. Had some wonderful, wonderful teachers at this school who made sure that I knew my history in America and instilled in me a sense of pride. I remember to this day, one of my teachers, Ms. Thompson, in the fifth grade, who would come to school wearing her dashiki, and she had this beautiful afro that she used to have, and she made us, would always make us recite this poem by Jesse Jackson, saying that I may be poor, I may be rich, but I am somebody. And she would come in and she would have us, all of us kids, remember that poem, that saying, and recite it, you know, instilling in us a sense of pride. One incident I remember, in particularly in elementary school, that made me want to become a social worker. I remember I was maybe about 5 or 6 years old, and every year our school would take us on a picnic to a park, and the school would fix brown bag lunches for us, and they would take us to the park where we would have a school picnic. And I remember this one year. When I went, we went to the picnic, I was sitting there on the blanket and I was eating my lunch, and I looked up and there was this guy, this elderly man with a cart, and he was digging through the garbage can. And that made an impression on me. And it was the first time I ever saw homelessness in our community. And I remember just sitting there, just amazed. And to this day, I can see him so clearly and I can see his face. But in my mind, because I'm so young, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know why this man was digging in this garbage can, but I just kind of felt this compassion for him, you know, and wondering why is he digging in the garbage can? And this was my first time, I ever saw homelessness. And of course, I asked questions and it was explained to me that he was homeless. You know, later on, I asked questions and it was explained that he was homeless. And so in my mind, I thought, this is wrong. This is wrong. Why is anybody digging in a garbage can for food? And I think that was the first thing that ever happened that started pointing me in a direction of going into social work. Of course, at that time, my young mind couldn't wrap my head around it, and I didn't know what it was. It couldn't explain what a social worker was, but I just knew I think that was the thing that kind of lit the fire in me around being a social worker. I also had a person in our community who worked in the minimum jail facility during that time. And often she would, when I became a teenager, she would ask me to come with her to the facility to help her do certain things. And so I would like help file paperwork for her, but she would also let me sit in her like psychoeducation groups with the prisoners, and they would talk about different subjects. And I just noticed how she interacted with them, and I got to know some of their stories through there. And that's where I started really putting a name on becoming a social worker. When I saw her and saw the work that she was doing in the community and saw how she was beginning to change some of these men's lives. And many of them were men of color who were locked up. And so that's where my passion came in for wanting to make a difference in the criminal justice system. And so in my faith, and I talked about it earlier, you know, my mom instilled in me spirituality. I grew up in a very, very strict religion. I grew up Pentecostal. And for those of you who all know Pentecostals, they don't do anything. we weren't allowed to go to the movies. We weren't allowed to, you know, go a lot of different places and participate in a lot of different things, you know, and that's where my relationship with my sisters developed, because my sisters became my best friends. And so we were all, it brought us closer together. But like I said, it also, that I am grateful for that foundation of spirituality, because a lot of that is what takes me through as a legislator. My faith and my spirituality, I lean on it, and I depend on it a lot to get me through a lot of the rough times and the experiences that that I've had growing up. You know, and growing up, I went to school in my community, but because of my grades, and because my teachers considered me to be a bright student, one of the things they wanted me to do was go to a school outside of my community. And this was a school that prepares students for college. And so my teacher recommended that I take the test and I go to this school. And so I McDonald 35. And so I took the test, I got into school, and was accepted in this school. And it was the first time I ever been outside of my community, really, at this high school. And I had the community I grew up in were people on the lower economic scale, but this school, it was a mixture of different students from different backgrounds, different economic scales. And it was kind of a little shock to me going here, because coming from growing up in a community that's poor, I didn't have what a lot of these students have. I didn't have the clothes that they had. I didn't have the resources that they had. But I went to the school and I managed to graduate. But I can say this school, because I had to ride the bus to this school and had to walk through certain communities to get to this school, that's where I experienced my first, where I first experienced racism, in your face racism. Although my father growing up in Mississippi had talked about it, he would tell us about his experience during the Jim Crow era and during the civil rights movement. I had never personally experienced it until I was walking through this community to get to school, and this man, dog started barking. He was walking his dog and he started barking, and I was walking past and trying to avoid the dog. And his response to me was, "My dog don't like the N-word," is what he said to me. And I must have been 14 years old at the time. And it shocked me, because I had that was the first time I have experienced it, but it was something I kept to myself. I never told my parents or anybody that this happened to me. It's just kind of something that I just kind of kept close to me and didn't say anything about it. But it kind of opened my eyes and to a world. My innocence was lost during that time about the world and what the world is and the possibilities out there. So that was my first experience. So after I graduated high school, I went to college in Mississippi, and that's where I met my husband, my college sweetheart. We're still together to this day. We've been married 30 years, have two beautiful daughters who are grown now. Ended up in Utah because I was a sophomore. My husband was a senior. He had been flying out here to Utah, doing an internship. And so when he graduated, they offered him a full-time position. He asked me to marry him and move out here. Let's get married and move to Utah. And I said, okay, sound like a good idea to me. Although I have to tell you that my dad said, "You're foolish. Do you even know where Utah is? You're moving to Utah." But I took a chance and moved out here. We were so young. We were very young. I was 20. He was 23 when we married. So we were very, very young. and very fortunate that that we're still here and still together with a lot of work, a lot of praying, and a lot of working through issues. After I got out of here and after we were married for about 2 years, then I gave birth to my first daughter. And then I gave birth to my second daughter. After that, I decided I wanted to go back to school and wanted to finish my bachelor's degree. And so I did. And I got my undergraduate in business management. But it was working for Bureau of Land Management during that time, but there was something that wasn't satisfying me. There was something that kept seeming like it was off. Something wasn't right. But I did the job because I did what I had to do to help support my family during that time. Happened to be at church one Sunday, and one of our deaconesses at church called me over, and she was one of our seniors. Very spiritual woman, very spiritual, love her to death. And she was a retired social worker. And she asked me to come over and see her. And when I did, she took my hand and she looked at me and she said, you're not walking the path you're supposed to be walking. And I just kind of looked at her. She said, you should be a social worker. She said, that's the path that you should be on. You should really consider going back to school and getting a master's degree in social work. Little did she know I had already been thinking about it. So for me, that was a confirmation that, yeah, that is the path. And so I quit my job, went back to school, got my degree in social work. Started working with the homeless population. In fact, that's the population I requested to work for. And so worked that a number of years, working in substance abuse treatment, working in mental health, loved the job, love working with that population. I just have a passion and I just have this heart for them. To be able to figure out how do we lift people out of poverty and give them the tools they need and start breaking down some of the barriers that has been set in place that can help them move forward. And so did that for a number of years. Then it's one of the representative for our area during that time called me and asked me to come and have lunch with her. And she said, I've just noticed that how you interact with people in the community and how they respond to you. Have you ever thought about getting into politics? And I said, absolutely not. I am not getting into politics. There's no way I'm doing this. And she said, you know, you really should consider it. Because during that time, I was very, very active. My husband and I both were very active in the community because, you know, we had kids. And so we were active in the school. And we just believed that if you live in a community, you should give back in some way. You should volunteer your time or just give back. And so that's what we was doing. And so I told her absolutely not and gave her all the excuses and all the reasons why I could not, because I was still working on my master's degree. My daughters were young. I had a husband that traveled, and I'm like, I can't do this. Plus, I'm trying to do my internship and work a job. And so when she finally retired, she called me and she said, well, both of your daughters are away at college. You finished with your master's degree. You should consider running for this. And so I thought about it. I called some of my friends, my closest friends, together over to the house, and we discussed it because I knew that if I did this, not only was my life going to shift, but a lot of their lives are going to shift because all of them, we were in a tight circle. And these were the people I trusted. And so by the end of the night, we decided, yeah, you should do this because you can make a difference. And I mean, if you lose, then so what? My life is not that bad to begin with. I was living a pretty good life to begin with. So I ran for office and I won. I won. And it's been great. It's been a great experience. It's been, you know, I wish I could say that it's all been positive experience, but it's been a learning experience. It's been good. And I must say that the good outweigh the bad with me being a legislator. So I want to talk about the year 2020. That was, I think, the year that stretched and grew me more as a legislator than I could have ever imagined. It challenged me mentally. It challenged me spiritually. It was my growing year, and it pushed me way out of my comfort zone, which is, of course, I always say, out of your comfort zone is where the growth occurs. And so 2020 started off in February of no less, the Black History Month, with a woman walking into our caucus room and deciding to give me a label that says slave. So a little bit of that history: she was there lobbying around polygamy, an issue around polygamy and a bill that was coming out around polygamy. And making her point, me, the only Black person in the entire room, she felt it was appropriate to give me a label that said slave. And during the time, I chose not to respond in that moment. And in fact, actually got up and walked out of the room. It was one of my colleagues, Representative Romero, who did come in and respond to her. But I knew that I was in a position that if I responded to her through my hate and through the anger that I was feeling at that moment, that that would have been the subject. That would have been the headline. And I did not want that. So I chose to walk out of the room, because I had to clear my head and I had to think a little bit about how I was going to respond to this. And so what I ended up doing was, you know, I believe when I said earlier that there are those who have gone before me who have paved the way, and there are those who have done this before me who have, you know, who have more wisdom than I do. So I went to my elders in the community. I called a meeting with all of my elders in the community, my civil rights elders, those who've been on the front line fighting this long before I was even born. And I called a meeting together, and I said, I need to respond to this. Tell me the best path to take. And I took a little bit of wisdom from all of them. And in the end, it was decided your best response is not going to be a response. You will not give her the time of day in all of this. You're going to release a statement, and this is what we're going to say. And that was the decision, and it was the best decision I could have made. And I think we need more of that. I truly, truly, truly value our seniors and their wisdom. I can sit at their feet all day just taking in. You know, I tell people that I've never claimed to know everything, but I try to surround myself with people who are expert in different subject matters and try to get that wisdom from them. And so that's what I did, and that's how I responded from that. Needless to say, she didn't appreciate my response and went out on social media and attacked me verbally. But you know what? I stayed prayed up, and I used my spirituality to stay center in responding to all of this. And so that's how my 2020 started off. And then, you know, COVID hit. We had COVID to hit, which was very difficult. And that was another learning experience, because the district I represent, you know, I have all of these wonderful people in there who are middle to lower income individuals. And I have all of these wonderful people who are immigrants and refugees and undocumented residents. And And it's a great community. And unfortunately, COVID hit us hard. It hit my community very hard because I have a lot of workers in my community who people who work in a restaurant or work, you know, in the hotel industry and cooks and a lot of frontline workers. And so unfortunately, it hit us very hard. And trying to navigate that and having kids go online and having kids go online, but you have people who don't even have computers or let alone Wi-Fi in their home, and trying to navigate that and making sure that these young people were keeping up, many who are already behind, making sure that they are keeping up with what is happening in the school system. So then that happened. Then we had a windstorm. Then we had an earthquake. And then the murder of Mr. George Floyd happened. And, you know, I sat there in amazement and I watched a video of this man and the life being taken out of him at the hands of one of our police officers. And it was hard. That was one of the hardest things I've ever had to witness or watch. And then we know the civil unrest started. And it not only started across the United States, but it happened here in Utah. And I can say that when it first started happening, you know, I have this group up at the Capitol, we call ourselves the Quad Cod Caucus. And it's the minority legislators. We all have been each other's support system through all of this. And I'm so grateful for these women and men who have supported me and have kind of been my rock through all of this. But when all of this started, we all got on a Zoom meeting and knew that we had to speak out, that we had to lead out, and that we had to be the voice, because many of us had been working on these issues already for years and years and years. And people have always wondered why I speak out the way I do on a lot of issues and call a lot of issues out. And a lot of it is because I try to give voice to people whose voices are not normally heard. I want to make sure that their opinion, that I am representing them at the table. And so we got together and we met and decided we've got to speak out. We've got to say something. Fortunately, during the time, our representative, our leader in the House, Brad Wilson, also agreed with us and reached out to us and said particularly that he wanted me to lead out on this subject and be at the forefront of this. Of what was happening in the community, because I already started, and many of us in the Quad Caucus were already meeting with a lot of the leaders in the protests and having conversations with them around policy changes. And so we put together a press conference, and we went out and we called for peace, and we said, it's okay to protest, we get it. But let's do it very peacefully, and let's work to make policy changes to assure that this is not going to happen again. And so I was able to run a piece of legislation banning the knee on the neck, chokehold, as one of the methods that the police can use in the state of Utah. And I can tell you, Luz and I sat with the police long hours to come up with that piece of legislation. And that was one thing that we finally all agreed on. And still have been meeting with the police to try to make changes and to figure out what changes need to be made in the community to make sure that not only are citizens protected, but that our police officers are going home too. We want the citizens and the police officers at the end of the day to go home to their families. And so we were able to work on that and continuing to work on that. But I could tell you that was a long summer. And then I also had a ballot initiative to take slavery out of Utah's constitution, Amendment C. So in 2018, I discovered that this language was still in Utah's constitution. And what happened was I had been watching Colorado and what has been going on in Colorado. And, you know, it was only an initiative. It didn't pass the first time, but the second time it did pass. And have been watching it and watching it and not thinking that it was all a part of Utah's constitution also. And so my a reporter called me, Brittany Johnson, one night. I happened to be up late working one night, and she happened to text me and say, "Are you still up?" And I said, "Yes." So she said, so she called. And she said, "Rep, are you aware that slavery is still in Utah's constitution?" And my response was, "No, it's not." She said, "Yeah, it is. It is in Utah's constitution." And so she said, "I'm sending everything over to you now." And so she sent everything over to me. And I looked at it and she called me. She said, "Well, what's your thoughts? What do you think?" And I said, "Well, we gotta take this out." And what it says that if you are duly convicted of a crime that you could be placed back into voluntary servitude. And I know a lot of people say, "Well, that's not going to happen. And you shouldn't have done that." And some people say, "You're trying to take our monuments down. And this doesn't make sense." But words matter. Words matter. And we want everyone to feel comfortable in the state of Utah. And so that's what happened. It passed with 80%. I want to send a shout out to Ross Chamberlain, who I took this to him. And when he saw it, he was like, "I'm on board. I'm working with you on this." And I tell you, he's been a rock with our communication and assuring that this, him and Coletta Lynch, are assuring that this passed by 80% on our ballots, which I am so absolutely proud of. I want to encourage you all, because this is a national movement that's going on, to take it out of other state constitution and to eventually go after the 13th Amendment. If you all have not had a chance, I would encourage you to go on Netflix and watch the documentary 13th, and you'll understand why removing this language was so important in our state constitution. So that was my 2020, and I could tell you that like I said, it stretched me in ways that I could not have imagined that I would be stretched, and it challenged me, but it was good. It was good, and I grew up fast legislative-wise with dealing with all of these challenges in 2020. And so with that being said, I think we're getting to the end, and I was supposed to end at 10:40. So I don't want to take up too much time. I want to leave some time for questioning. But some of the other things I'm working on right now is redistricting. I'm on a redistricting committee. I was asked to work on that, which is taking up a lot of my time, but I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying what I'm doing. And I think that's one of the biggest things I'm working on right now, is trying to understand that and make sure that those boundaries are drawn fairly. And I would encourage all of you, if you have opportunity, to come to one of our meetings that's going to be traveling around the entire state of Utah, to come out, because your voice is very important in all of this. And we want to make sure we hear you and that you have an input into how these maps are drawn. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Don.
Churches in general are facing some tough times with declining participation, and yeah. Black churches seem to be the glue that holds the communities together. Mm-hmm. How are Black churches faring in this COVID and everything else is happening?
You know what? We have gone online, and that's a good question. We have gone online, and we're still meeting in that way, and we're still doing Bible study, and we're still doing services. I have not gone back into church because of my fear of COVID, but mm-hmm. I attend Calvary Baptist Church with Dr. Moses mm-hmm. as my pastor. But as far as I can see, I think I can only speak to our church, and that it is continuing to move forward.
Okay, one of the questions has to do with, so there are two major components into this redistricting. One is the Independent Redistricting Commission that's appointed, and the other is a legislative committee that is going to be doing, so both of these bodies are going to be conducting public hearings, right?
Yes. And yes, both of these bodies.
And after that, then the Independent Commission is going to do what?
So after that, the Independent Commission is, after they collect all their data and public opinion, they're going to give a recommendation to the Legislative Committee on how the boundaries should be drawn. And so both committees are meeting with the public. So you can meet with one, or you can meet with both. You can come out to both. If you go on the Utah State website, you will see us out there, and you should be able to go in and give your opinions and information also on that, and look at the maps and draw the maps, and then come out to one of our meetings and give us your opinion on it. But the Independent Commission, you know, that was done by Proposition 8. Which said that they wanted a commission put together that was nonpartisan, that look at the data from the census and look at these maps and make a recommendation. So yes, they both work independent of each other, but they are giving us their recommendations.
And when it gets right down to drawing the maps, how much of that is open to the public, or is that all closed committee work?
It would be, you know what, the committee will be meeting in public. It will be in public as we're doing the work. So we're trying to be as transparent as possible. So I'm going to say it's going to be an open meeting as we're doing this.
Okay. All right. Critical race theory. The legislature passed a resolution on critical race theory. That is not binding. Is that correct?
It's not binding. No, it's not.
But what influence does it have on, say, the school systems?
Right now, well, first let me do a disclosure. I'm not going to pretend to know everything about critical race theory. I am studying it just like a lot of other people and trying to get all of the right information and accurate information around it. The resolution is non-binding, but this upcoming session, you can expect to see legislation around this, is what I have been told. You're going to see that's going to try to make it binding. It is very concerning to me, especially at the, well, first of all, critical race theory is not taught in Utah schools, but to bind what is being taught at a college level and saying that we're going to restrict our professors and what they can and can't teach at the, you know, it's supposed to be college is supposed to be a place where your thoughts are challenged, and to say, we don't want this, we don't want you all challenged on this, is very, very concerning to me. So no, it's not binding now, but it may become binding in January in the next legislative session.
I guess everyone is concerned with the final outcome. And do you see much of a difference in outcome from what we have now than what we're going to have after the legislative committee gets finished with their work?
Are we going to have much of an outcome as far as the redistricting?
Yes, different. How much difference is it going to be?
Yeah, there's going to be some difference. When you sit and you look at the data, there are some districts like mine that have lost population, which means they're going to have to expand to bring some more people into my district. And there are some districts that have grown tremendously, which means they're going to have to downsize a little bit. So I guess if you will, and split those districts up, some of those people up. And so I think there's going to be a significant change in the drawing of the boundaries.
Okay. You've done an awful lot of work on the school to prison pipelines.
Yes.
Where kids are just problem children are funneled into the criminal system, the juvenile criminal system. How would you rate the progress we're making on shutting down this pipeline?
You know, I think that it's slow and steady progress. I can tell you that I was told by one of our police chiefs that in the school system that the number of contacts between officers and SROs and the students have been decreasing, which is very good news because, you know, the study and the research has shown that if you have those contacts, it increase your risk of being suspended. And when you suspend it, increase your risk of dropping out of school. And so I think the progress is slow and steady. My wish now is to try to collect all of the data and to also have some barriers in place, some steps in place that instead of us just suspending kids, that we have some steps in place that prevent those kids from being kicked out of school altogether. I think that, you know, there are some things that warrant suspension. I agree with that, but I think that there are some things and some safety nets that we can have set up in the school system to keep these kids in out in the system. I could tell you that I'm without kids in the school system right now and COVID and everything, I am concerned with a lot of our kids at home with the online learning, us teachers not being able to lay eyes on our kids. And I understand the COVID and I get it. And I would prefer online learning. I have my daughter is a school teacher. And one of the things I tried to encourage her was to try to push for online learning because I'm concerned about COVID and her. But I tell you, I'm also concerned about what safety nets we have set up for these kids that are at home and making sure that they're safe.
You mentioned that you've worked on police reform. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that concerns me is use of force policies police departments have. And I think mm-hmm. that across the country, the standard use of force policy is if you have to shoot, shoot to kill. Mm-hmm. Is there any way to change that, seriously reconsider the use of force? Or is that a legitimate thing for police to be using?
You know, that's a tough question. My concern is also the use of force also. And how do we, like I said earlier, make sure that our citizens and our police officers are going home safely. I have been in conversation with police officers and with police chiefs, and I can tell you that they are concerned about use of force and how do we minimize that, the use of force. I know Angela Romero ran a bill this past session that said that they wanted to start collecting data that every time the police points his gun, they wanted to collect that data to know every time they even point their gun, let alone use it. So I guess my answer to your question is I don't know. I think that there are some other alternatives that could be used. Mm-hmm. But like everything else, I'm still looking at it. I'm still studying it. I would prefer use of force not be used unless absolutely necessary. I would prefer a person to be able to make it to the court system, to be able to get a trial. It's my thing. And really concerned about people when our police are called in for issues around mental health, especially, you know, and really concerned about the young man, 13-year-old young man who was shot by police. I want to say that he had autism. And so it's complicated. When I wish I could say it was so easy, but it's just so complicated trying to figure it out. But I am, we have been meeting other legislators. We have been meeting with the police department. We've met with them on a regular basis, trying to figure it out and trying to come to solutions in the community.
Okay. Last question here, and has to do with racism and your experience with it. You started off telling us when you were very young, your first experience with it, the really gross example you had in the legislature. What are some of the current experiences that you've got with racism that we would probably find surprising.
Oh, wow. I have gotten those emails from individuals along with some of my colleagues, some of those nasty emails. Whenever you speak out, or whenever I speak out against racism, or I speak at a rally or anything, I risk the backlash. I risk backlash from it and getting those emails or those nasty phone calls from it. I can tell you this, when I first was elected to office and I won the convention to be on the ticket, my husband, about a couple of weeks later, I guess, my husband and I went out to dinner. And on our way back, when we pulled into the yard, we noticed this light on the inside of his truck. And my husband was like, I didn't leave a light on. So he opened the truck in this flame. Somebody set my truck on fire. Someone set it on fire, and it was this flame that happened. And so then later that week, we noticed in the back of our yard, in the back of our house, our lights were shot out. Our security lights were shot out. And so that's something that happened. And it was, we were told, oh, this was just kids being kids. We're like, well, no, somebody did this with a purpose, because my husband had money inside of his ashtray. That wasn't taken. It wasn't taken at all. And somebody had purposely set the truck on fire to send a clear message. Now, my daughters were away at college, and I could tell you, it scared me enough that I thought about not going forward with this race. But I have an aunt, my Aunt Lee, who was on the front line during the entire civil rights movement, going to jail. I mean, she was a civil rights activist in Mississippi. She called me, she found out what happened, and she called me and she said, I once stood toe to toe on the Capitol steps of Mississippi with a member of the KKK. She said, and I didn't back down throughout that whole civil rights movement. Do not back down. She said, I don't care what happened, you stand your ground. And she started talking about my family history and say, look, this is a part of who you are. This is in your DNA. You come from a long line of people who have been fighting for change in this community. And she said, don't you dare ever back down. And that's what keeps me and has kept me on the front line. Because even though she passed a couple of years ago, those words keep ringing in my head. Don't back down. Don't back down. You stand your ground no matter what happens. Stand your ground. And so, that's one of the things, you know, and I have little subtle things that happen to me. You know, when things happen on a daily basis, just navigating in Utah is difficult. You know, you just have little things that happen that you unfortunately become a part of your norm. You know, I remember going into this one restaurant and the girl behind me looked at the person behind me and said, how can I help you? And I'm like, I'm standing here. What do you mean? How can you help her? I remember my husband and I, we were in Boston at a legislative convention and we went and sat down and we were refused service. Nobody would serve us. And we finally got the message and got up and left and ended up going to another restaurant. But yeah, we were refused service at this restaurant. So things like this happens, it's still happening. You know, I can go on social media and start pointing it out every single day, but I mean, it's tiresome. It is very, very tiresome, and it is draining to go through.
Sandra, thank you very much for
your
this morning, and thanks for spending the time with us.
Dylan? Oh, thank you all. And I hope to be able to visit you all's church one day.
Good.
We would absolutely love to have you.
I would love to be there.
Again, yes. Thank you, Representative Hollins. And one of the disadvantages to Zoom meetings like this is that you can't hear applause, but believe me, it's there. Thank you so much for joining us today. And we really appreciate you taking the time and sharing some of your stories and some of your experiences, both in your life and as a legislator.
Thank you.